psychological depth of a kiddie pool. They might refer to the events of the Bible. They may even mention the name of Jesus. But the vast majority of their content is not found in Scripture. And sometimes their message is even explicitly opposed to Christianity. Now, we could spend the rest of our time this evening talking about those so-called Christmas carols, but tonight is Christmas Eve, and tomorrow is Christmas, and so in the spirit of the holiday, I would like to be charitable, and I do not want to make you tune me out when you're listening, because I do not like your favorite Christmas carol. So instead of talking about bad songs that are wrong in their content, I would like to talk about a good song with excellent content reflecting God's word. But that leads to the second problem with Christmas carols. People may know the song, but they might not understand what its words mean. We might like the music or the arrangement, but we rarely take the time to consider what the song is actually saying. And so what I want to do with the rest of our time this evening is something that's different for me and maybe different for you. I want us to look at the lyrics of a particular Christmas carol and see how they reflect the Bible and reflect its center, Jesus Christ. The song we're going to look at this evening is one that we've already sung, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. And as we go through the song, you can follow along. I put a green sheet in your bulletin that has the lyrics that we'll talk about. Now, before I begin, there are a couple things I have to make very clear. Hark the Herald Angels Sing is not in the Bible. It is not inspired by God. The words are not directly from God, and they are not without error. If you're interested in the history, the song was written in 1739 by Charles Wesley, a man who wrote over 6,000 hymns, but the lyrics were updated, revised about 14 years later by a contemporary of his named George Whitefield. But that was just the lyrics. The music that we associate with the song was not written until almost 100 years after the lyrics were put together. The music was composed in 1840 by Felix Mendelssohn. All this is to say that Hark the Herald Angels Sing is not perfect. It is not inspired by God. Only Scripture, only the Bible is 100% from the Lord. You might not like this song at all, and that's fine, because in the end, it really does not matter. But what I hope you will see this evening is that the truths in the Bible, the truths in God's Word that Hark the Herald Angels Sing points to, I hope you'll see these truths and then also see the person behind them, Jesus Christ. My hope is that after tonight, you will think about the Bible and its message from this day forward, whenever you hear Hark the Herald Angels Sing, and that you'll be able to use the lyrics of this song to point others to the truth of Scripture and the person and work of Jesus Christ. So let's begin. The song opens with, Hark the Herald Angels Sing, Glory to the Newborn King, Peace on Earth and Mercy Mild, God and Sinners Reconciled. It starts off telling us that we are to hark, we are to listen, to pay attention to the news of God's heavenly messengers. Now, the immediate background for this opening phrase is a passage that we've already read from Scripture, Luke 2, 8 through 14, which reads, And in the same region there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and they were filled with fear. And the angel said to them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased. On the night that Jesus was born, the angels sang praises to him and told of the peace that he would bring. He would be king not just of a particular nation, but king over all creation. He would rule over all, and his rule would be one of peace. Now you could argue, but Pastor John, I watch the news. I sometimes look in a newspaper. There are wars and death all over the place. And Jesus died like 2,000 years ago. Clearly, he is not the king of the universe. He obviously failed to bring this peace. And my friend, you are sadly right to recognize that our world is full of violence and death. But I'd say maybe you are thinking about the word peace the wrong way. The last phrase that we had looked at in this song helps us define peace. What is peace on earth and mercy mild? It's the next phrase, God and sinners reconciled. Now, reconciled is not a word that we use very often today. It refers to restoring a relationship. Occasionally, we might talk about how a couple separated for a time, but then they came back together and they reconciled. Here in this song, it refers to how Jesus has restored, he has fixed the severed relationship between a holy, perfect God and sinful men and women. Now, we'll see later how Jesus will eventually return to bring true peace, absolute peace, freedom from sin, war, and death. But the peace that this verse of the song is talking about is peace with God. Listen to how the Apostle Paul explains it in Colossians 1, 21 and 22. He says, "And you who were once alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he has now reconciled, restored you in his body of flesh by his death. Why? In order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him, before God." And then he also says in 2 Corinthians 5:19, "In Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them." Friends, our sin, our rebellion, our trespasses, our disobedience against God separated us from him and made us his enemies. He created us to be together forever, but we broke that relationship. Our sin broke that bond. But Jesus, the little baby whose birth we celebrate this evening, he grew up. He lived a perfect life and then took the punishment that our sins deserved. For those who turn to him in repentance and faith, God no longer counts their trespasses, their sins, against them, because he has already counted them against Jesus Christ. If we turn from sin and turn to Jesus, putting all our faith, trust, and hope in him, he makes us holy, blameless, and above reproach before God. Our relationship with God is restored, and we are reconciled. And this is the peace and glory brought by the newborn king. So how are we to respond to this news of reconciliation? Well, the carol tells us, "Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies, with the angelic host proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn king." The news of Jesus entering the world, of peace between God and mankind, is to be proclaimed by all nations, by all peoples. The shortest psalm or song in the Bible has the exact same message. This is Psalm 117. It says, "Praise the Lord, all nations. Extol him, all peoples. For great is his steadfast love toward us, and the faithfulness of the Lord endures forever. Praise the Lord." Here and throughout the Old Testament, it looks forward to the day when peoples from all nations and languages will worship the one true God. God told many of his prophets, his human messengers, that this time would come. The prophet Isaiah says to God's people in Isaiah 60:1-3, "Arise, shine, for your light has come. The glory of the Lord has risen upon you. Behold, darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples,
But the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will be seen upon you. And here's the reference to the song. And nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising. Before Jesus, God revealed himself to one particular people, but now everyone is able to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. His substitute sacrifice on the cross enables all who turn to him to rightly relate to God. After his crucifixion and his resurrection from the dead on the third day, Jesus achieved the victory of bringing honor, praise, and worship to God. And we see the greatest example of this triumph in the skies in a passage that was read earlier, Revelation 5, 11 through 13, where the author says, he heard around the throne living creatures, elders, the voice of many angels, numbering myriads of myriads, thousands of thousands, all saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them saying to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever. Just as the angels proclaimed Christ's birth in Luke 2, people from all nations are to pick up and carry on their message. God, the one absolutely perfect person in the universe, is worthy of all praise and worship. Without forgiveness of our sin, we could not worship him. But thanks to the coming and the work of the sacrificial lamb, Jesus Christ, we can now joyfully respond in worship. The carol, Hark the Herald Angels Sing, switches gears in the second verse to talk about who Jesus is. It tells us he is Christ by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord. Late in time, behold him come, offspring of a virgin's womb. Jesus' mother, Mary, was told by the angel Gabriel that you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Mary would give birth to the promised king, a descendant of the Israelites' greatest king, David. But this king would be God himself, and he would reign forever. The problem with this promise was that when Mary heard it, she was a virgin. So let's look at what follows. Mary said to the angel, "How will this be, since I am a virgin?" And the angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God, for nothing will be impossible with God." And this is extremely important because if the Savior, if the Messiah had a human father, he would not be able to save us because of our sin nature, our predisposition to rebel against God. That is why Jesus was miraculously conceived by the Holy Spirit. He was still fully man, but he was also fully God, able to live a perfect life and die to save us from sin. One of the phrases I read, "late in time," reminds us of the timing of this coming. If you were here last year, last Christmas Eve, I spent a good deal of time talking about how perfect the timing of Jesus' arrival was. I'm not going to go over those details again tonight, other than to say that Jesus was born at the perfect time, in the perfect place, and in the perfect way to accomplish God's plan to save sinners. But it's not that Jesus began his existence at that first Christmas. Because as the carol says, "Veiled in flesh the Godhead see, hail the incarnate deity, pleased as man with men to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel." Jesus did not come into existence at Christmas or when he was conceived in Mary's womb. He has always existed and will always exist because he is God. Hebrews 1:3 describes it this way. He is the radiance of the glory of God, the exact imprint of his nature, and he upholds the universe by the word of his power. Friends, Jesus is the second part of the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And the Trinity is a mystery and reality worth far more time than I can give it this evening. The point we are to draw from Hark the Herald Angels Sing and from Scripture is that Jesus is God. He is part of the Godhead and true, full deity. Yet even though Jesus is God, he was born as a little baby that night in Bethlehem and lived like any other human. The opening of John's gospel says that the Word, Jesus, became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. He veiled, he covered, disguised his deity in human flesh. He became incarnate, a physical, real person. He left heaven to become a human and live among his creation. We've already talked about why the coming of the 100% God, 100% man, Jesus Christ, was necessary. But it's also a fulfillment of God's promises. In his account of Jesus' birth, Matthew explains that all this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. And here he quotes Isaiah, "Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Jesus was born, God became one of us. He became human. We do not have to wonder if God knows what it's like to be human, because the Bible tells us that he was one. He experienced the emotions and pain that each of us feel. Hark the Herald Angels Sing reminds us that Jesus was pleased. He was happy to become human, to be Emmanuel, God with us. He was glad to fulfill God's plan of salvation, to be born, to live, and to die to save those who would turn to him. Now the final verse of Hark the Herald Angels Sing begins with this: "Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness, light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings." Now the first phrase we see here, "Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace," that probably makes sense to us. After all, we heard earlier a quotation from Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 and 7, where it said, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." And this refers in part to the peace with God that we already talked about, and partly to Christ's future reign of peace still to come that will last for all eternity. However, the second part of this verse may confuse us, this "Hail the Son of Righteousness." Son of Righteousness? What does that mean? That has to be a misprint there. Pastor John must have put that wrong up there. Surely it means S-O-N, Son of Righteousness, because Jesus is righteous and good, and he is God's Son, right? But actually, S-U-N, Son of Righteousness, is correct. And why? Because it is a reference to the last book of the Old Testament, to a promise of the Lord and a prediction of the prophet Malachi. I want you to listen to Malachi chapter 4, verse 2, and see if it sounds familiar. He says, "But for you who fear my name, And how does this healing happen? Well, the Apostle Peter tells us that he himself, Jesus, bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. Christ's death on our behalf heals us from the sickness of sin and grants us Christ's righteousness, his standing before God. Because of Christ, we who were once God's enemies are now made right and whole in his eyes. Now finally, the carol closes with what Jesus was born to accomplish. It reads, "Mild he lays his glory by, born that man no more may die, born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth." This is why Jesus was born, and this is why we celebrate Christmas. In order to become man and to die for sin, Jesus had to sacrifice the honor and the praise that was owed to him. For although Jesus was in the form of God, he did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. He laid aside his glory so that those who trust in him would not suffer spiritual death in hell, but be raised, born again to new life. As the Apostle Peter save us, then we will be born again. We will receive the inheritance of a relationship with God now and a home with him when we die. The carol ends with one final refrain of "Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn king," that reminds us that because of Jesus' work, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. He laid aside his glory to save us, but he will receive it from every person when he returns. Now at this point you might be thinking, but what does all of this mean for me today, right now? Well, my friend, "Hark the Herald Angels Sing" is painting a picture for you of who Jesus Christ is. It is telling us the significance of that child born in the little town of Bethlehem all those years ago. He is the King who reconciles men and women to God. People from every nation and language will praise this virgin-born God in human flesh. God with us is a Son of righteousness that brings light and life because he sacrificed his glory to save his enemies, to save sinners, to save us. And this king and his work demand a response. Friends, words have meaning. "Hark the herald angels sing" has meaning. And I hope that from now on you will remember that. I pray that every time you hear this song, you will think about the one the song is about and dwell on what he did for you. After tonight, you can ignore what the song says about Jesus, but you can never again claim that you do not know what the Bible says about the one the angels praised. And there are many more passages of Scripture that we did not even look at tonight that talk about what "Hark the Herald Angels" proclaims. But you don't have to take my word for it. All of the Bible is about Jesus. And as you read it and hear it taught, you will come to see him. But as for this evening, my friends, how will you respond to God's word on this, the night that we celebrate the arrival of Jesus in human form? If you do not have a relationship with Jesus, you can talk to me after the service or talk to someone you know who is a believer about how you can know him. Now, perhaps you're here, you have questions about what I've said tonight, about Christianity, about Jesus, about this church, and you're more than welcome to either ask me, you can ask Pastor Brian, or any member of our church would be more than happy to talk to you and answer your questions about Jesus. You can talk to us after the service or get contact information available online. But if you're here tonight and you do know Jesus, I hope tonight was a reminder for you of the reason for the season. From now on, I hope that you will not just listen to Christmas carols to enjoy them, but that you will ponder what they are saying about our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I pray that as you read the Word of God and live for Him, your mind will always be focused on the King who reconciles God and sinners. I pray that you will worship Him in song and by how you live. And with that in mind, right now I'd like to invite the worship team to make their way up on stage. Because friends, here's how I'd like to conclude our time together. I want us to praise the one who Christmas Eve is all about. We already sang a version of Hark the Herald Angels Sing earlier in the service this evening, but I would like all of us to sing the verses of this song one more time now that we've taken a few minutes to consider the lyrics of this carol. And as we're singing, I'd ask you not to think about the music or even the lyrics themselves per se, but I want you to focus on the one the song is about, the newborn King, Jesus Christ. So my friends, would you please stand and let us worship because He alone is worthy.